Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us this evening. For those very familiar faces, welcome back. For those who are new to DIET, welcome. My name is Alison Cobbin, and I'm the head of school. And I'm really pleased to be able to welcome you to this information evening all about the IB, which is a wonderful thing if you're new to it, or if, like me, you've been part of the IB community for many years, it's still wonderful to reflect on what an IB education is. So this evening, obviously, we really do wish that we could welcome you into our school, but I do know there are some advantages of being able to join us from the comfort of your own home. So I hope everybody's comfortable and looking forward to the evening together. When you've been in IB education for a long time, it is tempting, or it's possible that you might take it for granted, or perhaps just get used to it. You know, there are so many acronyms, there are so many bits of jargon that we can use, and sometimes it makes it sound more complicated than it really is. But it really is a different kind of education if you've come from a different education system, and there are many ways in which an IB education prepares young people for the future. And this evening, we're just going to be looking at a few of them. I'm really pleased that we have Chris Beddoes here, who's going to host the evening for us. Chris is a member of IBEN, which means he's part of the IB Education Network. And that means that he goes and does presentations about the IB and workshops about the IB for other schools as well as for us. And we are very lucky to have him as our upper school principal. And I'm going to hand over to him now. Thanks, Chris.
Alison, thank you. Good evening, colleagues, parents, prospective parents. I promise we'll be fully wrapped up before I'm a celebrity. Get me out of here. And I thank you for stopping your binge watching of The Crown for these few kind of short half-hour sessions that we've got this evening. A very warm welcome to everybody as we embark really on thinking this evening about why is the International Baccalaureate Education at DWIT the number one curriculum for the future. And when we think of the future, we think of many different things. The future could be tomorrow, it could be next week, it could be next month, or it could be in years' time when the students are heading off into the world of work. And we're going to focus on a few things that we think DWIT does really, really well that prepares our students for the future. And you'll see there we've got an evening overview. Very excited about this evening overview, really. It's very dynamic. And as Alison mentioned, collaboration has been tough. Even when we're in school with our colleagues, collaboration is tough. So the breakout sessions that you'll see there have really been innovatively worked upon by electronic means with teachers across the lower school and the upper school working together to create these breakout sessions. You're going to hear from me for a few moments to start off with as we give an introduction and I talk about the IB for the future. Less interactive than I would like it to be, given the forum that we're using. Then from 6:30, we're going to go into two breakout sessions. Breakout session one and breakout session two. I'll provide the links for those breakout sessions on the final slide of this presentation, and I'll leave that slide up, and this room will always be open for you to come back to and check in. I'll be here, Miss Cobham will be here, and Mr. Parkin will be here as well for you to kind of pop back to and answer any questions should you need to. And then at 7:15, if you want to come back to the main meet room, Ms. Cobham, Mr. Parkin and myself will be here to answer any questions. So there are the breakouts, ATL skills, learner profile, pathways to university and beyond, wellness, spark tank and action. Some of that you might be thinking, what are you on about, Chris? Well, I'll break down some of these later on, and you'll find out when you choose which breakouts to go to more about these things. I'm recording this session, and hopefully the breakout session leaders, led by some of our wonderful faculty, will also record their sessions. So if you don't get to the breakouts that you wanted to go to, you'll be able to view those later on. I'm just going to pause for 30 seconds and ask you to check in with yourselves. Why are you here this evening? And what do you hope the biggest takeaway from this evening is? Just have a think about that for 10, 15 seconds before we move on. And maybe think about, well, which breakouts you want to learn more about, which ones you want to tackle and embark upon. Okay, so keep that in your mind about why you're here this evening and what your biggest takeaway is as we move through these initial slides. And I always like to start with why I'm here, why I'm in education, and what drew me to the IB was its mission statement. In particular, I'll let you read that there, but in particular, the words create a better and more peaceful world. We certainly need that in the world. Better can be many different things, but for our students to be going out there and creating a better and more peaceful world is very, very important. And also in the second paragraph there, become active and compassionate and lifelong learners. They're kind of the words that I hang true to my own philosophy of education, stick with me every day and the decisions that I have to make and my work with students. Yeah, but that idea of creating a better and more peaceful world is hugely, hugely important. And this is where we are. We are a continuum school, a proud continuum school. And what does that mean? It means we do the IB throughout from age 3 to age 19. It starts with the primary years program, the PYP, really focuses on the development of the whole child, holistic education there. Then we go to the MYP, and we look at the life skill development there and the academic challenge. And then we go to the diploma. No doubt a demanding two-year curriculum, but it really does meet the needs and really satisfies the appetite of the most eager learners and the highly motivated students. And throughout the IB continuum at Dwight, students are supported for each stage of their journey, and they don't operate in isolation. Each program builds to the next, and there's a transition program that we put in place to make sure that students are set up for success as they embark on that journey. Again, the future could be the MYP for our PYP students, and the diploma program for our MYP students moving on to that way. A little bit about Dwight, you might not know this. We're a proud family of schools. Most of our schools do the IDB continuum. Dwight Dubai, our newest school, is going to get there when they get authorized to do the diploma. But we're part of this strong family of IB schools, and we are trailblazers. We were the first at doing many, many things connected to the IB. And we're all pulling in the same direction, and that's to grow and develop as this family of IB schools to really prepare our students, whether they're in America, England, Dubai, Shanghai, or Seoul, to prepare them for the future and what's next. And the learner profile is central to these key ideas of the IB and Dwight, and they really stand the test of time, the learner profile. You can see there the 10 traits we weave into our education, our conversation, our collaboration every day, and we role model these. And really, these are almost like success criteria. If I was to pick up a student and drop them anywhere in the world, could they be all those things? Obviously, developmentally appropriate according to the age, but really, these are the outcomes of our mission statement that we're striving to be, these students to be balanced, reflective, all these really great words that we're thinking about. And when I say that statement to you, the International Baccalaureate is the number one curriculum for the future. Really, what do you think you know about the International Baccalaureate in terms of its future-proofing our students? What questions or puzzles do you have about this topic or this notion that the IB is number one for the future? And how might you explore the puzzles you have around this topic? And hopefully, when you think about the exploration phase and you listen to this initial presentation, you'll decide which breakout room to go to based on something you hear or based on an interest that you have. It's all about, these education evenings are really all about parent agency. As much as we love our students to be agents of their own learning, we like our parents to think about what they want to learn about this idea of the IB curriculum that we do so well at Dwight. So what will the future look like? I've got a few bits of research to share with you and a few surveys from familiar organizations. I'm sure you're aware of the first one here, LinkedIn. They did a 2018 survey thinking about what the future workforce will look like. I must apologize, by the way. You might be able to hear my son screaming in the background. He's currently enjoying a bath. That is the screaming in the background. I apologize for that if you can hear him. I don't apologize, actually. He's a 18-year-old kid. He screams. That's what he does. He's certainly not near a future workforce yet. But what will the future workforce look like? Well, 2018, LinkedIn said leadership, communication, collaboration, and time management. And I want you to think about your work life, your daily life. And I bet you that everyone on this call is thinking about one of those four things that they have to do in their daily existence. We have to time manage. We have to work with other people. We communicate daily and we exhibit different leadership styles. That might not be a leader in terms of a title sense, but we're all leaders in a different way. And what we're trying to do is weave these things in to our daily tapestry. And then the World Economic Forum, a very powerful organization, they meet every year and they often come up with these top 10 lists and these top 10 skills. If you look in 2015 compared to 2020, this is what they thought the future workforce would need and look like in 2015. complex problem solving at the top there, creativity number 10. In 2020, which is where we are now, they predicted back in 2015 that in 2020, the job market and the workforce would need these things. And if you look, there's a couple of new entries there. Emotional intelligence came onto the chart, cognitive flexibility. There's a really interesting one there. I love it. It's not a new one, but number 8, service orientation. Again, I'm going to pick a few of these and show you how we do these well at Dwight. But it's just interesting to think about what an organization like the World Economic Forum were predicting skills would be needed in the workplace, and how the IB and Dwight are actually organically preparing our students for the future workplace. And they've come out with another list. It's a top 10 skills of 2025, so in 5 years' time. Let me give you 10 seconds of thinking time there to see what you think will make that list, or what has been cut from that list. Thinking about, they last did it in 2015 and now they did it in 2020 to predict for 2025. I'm going to pause just for 10 seconds while you have a think. All right, well, let's see if any of yours made the list and made the cut. So in 2025, the World Economic Forum predict that these are some of the skills that are needed in the workplace and in our future jobs. Very interesting. I want to pick out a few of these. In particular, technology appears. Technology use, monitoring and control, technology design and programming. Thinking skills. That is a common thread that's been woven throughout all of these lists, is that thinking skills appear on there as well. And a very, very interesting one there, the penultimate one, talks about resilience, stress, tolerance, and flexibility. People call these soft skills. I don't think they're soft skills. I think these are life skills. These are skills that students, the future workers of the world need in terms of, you know, how they're going to go out there and be successful. So it's an interesting list. And I'm going to break this down in just a second and show you again how we weave all of these 10 skills into our education, into our curriculum. And our teachers probably don't know these top 10 skills lists, but organically they are doing this. And this is great for me as a school principal and for us as a leadership team to know that we are embedding these and thus preparing our students for the workplace. Again, the World Economic Forum, when they met, they kind of identified a shift in trend in the job landscape by 2025. There'll be 97 million new roles, and kind of this will displace 85 million things. And if you look at the growing job demand list there, very interesting, the shift towards technology. And interestingly, in this study that they did, they said that 1 in 2 workers now will need reskilling. Well, it's our job to make sure that our students go out there and don't need reskilling, but they are skilled already in that particular area. You know, the jobs of tomorrow, if you look at that, reflect new technology and demand for new products and services. We're a consumer-driven society now. However, what remains is human interaction is still important. Sales, marketing, content production, that's all still very, very important. That's why those interpersonal skills are all still very, very valuable. And personal development and self-management skills were flagged up as two areas where this growing job demand will focus on. It's just interesting there if you look at the kind of the push towards machines replacing humans, but there is this growing job demand still, and that's where the sector is going to be in 2025, according to their predictions. Very interesting. And the next one from the CBI, just a quote there, they always do a skills survey, the CBI, the British Industry governing body or the organization, talking about the importance of a positive attitude and broader skills such as, again, resilience, communication, problem solving, and aiming high and setting yourself good targets and good goals. Very, very important. They're all kind of words connected to the IB, and it's in our vocabulary bank at Dwight School. That positive attitude, resilience, and communication, I'm really pleased to see that on this survey front and center. And more research just to show what really moving towards the realm of university here and more than just careers is 7 skills that people are going to need. This is from Tony Wagner, a very eminent person in educational circles. Just what our students are needing to be equipped with. I love number 7, curiosity and imagination is great. And what struck me about this list, not a lot of that stuff you can work out from a test. not a lot of the stuff is going to show through an A-level, a GCSE, an IB exam. There is a place for exams, don't get me wrong, but these are the skills that employers are looking for and universities are looking for now. It's really commonplace at Dwight School. Assessing them is tricky, but developing them is not. And what do universities want? So moving away from the job sector into unis, and what are they looking for? Well, the University of East Anglia, some research came out of there that showed this idea of transitioning to college. And I know that some people on this meet will have children in the PYP. That's okay. We're future casting very far ahead right now. But they've shown that transition to college or university is a problem because some students struggle with those following things. They struggle with the following things. They lack the ability to inquire. Guess what? The IB is rooted in inquiry. They lack the ability to select sources and extract the relevant material. Well, we're all about research and analyzing a range of sources, disseminating between fake news and real news. So it's great that this all hits home for us and hopefully resonates with our current parents on this call. And universities want this. Enthusiasm for higher level learning. Enthusiasm and cognitive and effective skills. They do want scores. Obviously, we're governed by what the universities want and what their scores, what students' scores are needed. But when they go to interview, we get reports from universities say that our students, IB students, interview very well. They're very confident, very articulate. Their communication skills are above and beyond their A-level counterparts or their other curriculum counterparts there. So that's what universities are wanting. So I've set the stage there for what the industry and what research has shown that the future is going to look like. So how does Dwight foster these future skills? Well, we've got the IB continuum that you all know and love. The primary years program, as I mentioned earlier, the middle years program and the diploma program. Imagine that like a stepping stone. Each one does not operate in isolation. They build on each other from age 3 to 18. It is a continuum. An education that develops the whole child, not just this academic stuff, but also the empathy, the intercultural understanding, the respect, underpinned by this idea of students taking action and making a difference in their community is highly, highly important for the IB continuum. We develop approaches to learning skills throughout. One of our breakout rooms is about approaches to learning. And hopefully you'll recognize some of these terms from the World Economic Forum's 2025 list. They talked about self-management skills and they talked about thinking skills. And we are doing this, let me tell you, on a daily basis. Our students are developing these skills, whether it's self-managing their Google Classroom in the upper school, whether it's communicating in a different language, whether it's collaborating on the PYP exhibition in the lower school, whether they're researching from primary, secondary sources on field trips, transferring knowledge from one concept to another, from one subject to another. Approaches to learning is something that the IB is really, really great at. And Dwight, I think we do it great. And we track these skills all throughout the school. So hopefully when they leave us in the diploma, they've mastered, for want of a better term, they've fully developed to the best of their ability, these skills that are going to really set them up for success, whether that's at a BTEC level, a university level, a vocation, work experience, whatever they need to do. And developing these skills is more about academics. It's more about cognitive. Yeah, and I'll let you read that quote from Zimmerman yourself there. It's doing things for themselves and encouraging students to learn for themselves and viewing learning as something that they do, not something they have to do. It's about lifelong learning. If you look at that there, that quote, it's echoed in the design cycle that you'll hear about if you go to Spark Tank session. It's the inquiry cycle. It's really developing these other skills, these life skills, just as opposed to academics and the cognitive skills. And pulling out some of those words from the 2020 predictions that the World Economic Forum made, you can see their creativity, originality, and initiative. I could have picked out a number of things. I picked out Spark Tank and Forest School. For those of you who don't know what those are, Spark Tank's going to be a session this evening, so I don't want to spoil that for Mr. Turner, who's going to lead that. Forest School is our outdoor education program that we have through to year 7. I think it's innovative. I think it's creative. I think it's original. I think it encourages students to use their initiative in a different forum, and it's a perfect antidote to screen time. But just two things there that highlight those World Economic Forum top 20 skills. Technology use. Welcome to the world, everybody. Technology use is rife. We're monitoring that. Our students have education about online safety, online good practice. education about tech use and the balance between using too much, too less, citing your sources. In the upper school, we've implemented remote learning every Tuesday. We've realized the workplace is remote now. It might be like that for a while. It might be like that for the future. So our M5 students, year 11 and year 12 students, every Tuesday, they go off site and they learn from home, and our lessons are delivered remotely. And then leadership and social influence. Again, this is not, these words are not just from me. They're coming from this prediction of future success and future workplace skills. We have student council. We have MUN, Model United Nations. We have assemblies that are student-led. It really is all about the student and how we're preparing them to be leaders. And leaders doesn't mean standing on the stage and sharing information. Leadership can be very, very different, and it can be quiet leadership. It can be leading from the middle, leading from behind, leading from the front. And social influence. How are we influencing society to be better versions of ourselves, which again is much needed? And very simply, in these COVID times, resilience, flexibility, and agility, our teachers and our leaders in school are certainly developing these skills right now, but we're proud that our students are being able to develop. If we're taking nothing else out of these COVID pandemic times, it's the fact that our students are developing great resilience, grit, for want of a better word. They're being flexible in the way they learn, the methods that they learn, and they're being agile with their thinking. Learning might not be always easy for them remotely. It might not be always be easy with frontal teaching, which we do now to maintain social distance, but the students are showing great resilience, flexibility, and agility, which makes me very proud in the world that we're in, that we're doing this organically, and something good's going to come out of it. And then three milestone projects of the IB that Dwight does and the schools around the world do. The PYP exhibition, collaboration is rife for the PYP exhibition, teams of students working together on a shared project. The MYP personal project involves innovation, research, deep, deep research about a passion project. Students develop a product. And the extended essay, research, thinking skills goes into that. Some of the topics that these students come up with for the 4,000 word extended essay is quite incredible. But again, it's citing sources, and they build on each other. The skills from the exhibition bleed into the personal project, and they bleed into the extended essay. One common thread is really student agency. Students get to choose the direction of their learning, the pace of their learning, the topic of their learning, the direction of their learning. And community, I think what final thing to wrap up with on this part, if you like, is that when I thought about putting together this presentation, is when I thought about the future and I thought about the world, I think our community is a very nice snapshot of the world that we live in. It's very diverse in the sense of culturally, socioeconomically, people learn in different ways, and that's okay. And I think our community really is a good indication of preparing students for the future, because they're interacting with people who are different than themselves. They're learning skills from their friends. They're learning from each other. And our community is really a big part of future-proofing for our students. A little bit more research as we lead into our breakout sessions really here is that you can see for yourself there that IB students, it's clear, have a leg up over their national counterparts who don't do the IB. Retention in university, graduation rates, diploma graduates within the four years of a university program, all are increased over their national rate there, because they are prepared for the challenge of university, because university is a challenge and college is a challenge. Colleges in the US, in addition to funding, they provide generous course credit. So many universities in the USA, they provide credit for the first year, recognizing the robustness of the diploma program and the IB program throughout. The same with the MYP. Students going to do A-levels, A-level schools often recognize and comment on the work ethic and the mentality of MYP students. And you can see there a 2013 study that really just highlights the significant strength of the IB there in terms of preparing students for university coursework. They really can hit the ground running when it comes to university. And they found that the research skills, the thinking skills are all set up so the students succeed at their next stepping stone. And then thinking longer term from students who would do the IB, from a continuum program, they're likely to outperform their peers, higher proportions of attainment in areas of connectedness, deep learning, not just surface learning, it's deep learning. And there's just evidence throughout the globe to show that the IB, which Dwight does very, very well, sets the students up for future success. And I like the quote at the bottom there from Fordham, a great college in New York City there. I'll let you read that for yourself. The IB students, you know, it's not just 21st century skills. Where students are often labeled as historians, mathematicians, scientists. So they become the guys of that career, of that profession. And they're comfortable with primary and secondary source materials. And we're going back to the idea of being flexible and agile. As a school, our curriculum is flexible and agile. We're not there. We've got a framework that we work within, and it evolves and changes daily based on the students' interests and based on our staff's passions as well. And speaking of our staff passions, I'm delighted to announce these breakout rooms. They're led by, in my opinion, some of the best in the business. I've worked in international schools around the world, and we've got some phenomenal educators who go above and beyond. They're there for the students, but they're masters of their craft. These are led by a combination of primary school teachers, secondary school teachers, and higher teachers in the diploma program who've worked together to create these 20-minute windows in to different elements to do with the IB at Dwight that prepare students for the future and future success. Now, how you access these breakout sessions. So the first one's going to start in a few moments' time when I say go. Hold your horses, though. This is where students go straight away now, but pause just for a few seconds. You can type into your toolbar at tinyurl.com and then / whichever breakout you want to. I'll keep this up so you don't need to worry. And then anytime you want to come back and remind yourself of these breakout rooms and sessions, this screen will always be up on the IB Education main page there. Don't worry if you're struggling to get into a breakout room. The teachers are there. They will admit you, so just be patient because you need to admit them into these rooms. But enjoy. You've got ATL breakout approaches to learning, action, learn all about the different action components of the IB, a university breakout, uni breakout led by Mr. Bowery, a learner profile breakout, a wellness breakout, and a spark tank breakout led by Mr. Turner there. You can choose two of those. This first session will finish at 6:50, and then we'll have a 5-minute break while you figure out your way to the next room, and then we'll have the second session. And at 7:15, please do feel free, if you've got any questions, to come back to this main IB Education main section or site and ask any questions to Ms. Cobham, Mr. Parkin, or myself. But without further ado, off you go and jump into a breakout room and enjoy your first 20-minute experience. And just a hearty thanks for joining us this evening. It really is a pleasure to see so many familiar, but also so many new faces. Enjoy your breakouts. Off you pop.